Okay, we will get started. I anticipate that we will have more people joining us in a few minutes as everyone gets their coffee or tea prepared probably for what should be a really engaging presentation. So good morning, everyone, and welcome to today's presentation entitled Attracting Immigrants to Rural Areas During the COVID-19 Pandemic. My name is Jamie Bramberger. I'm the Manager of Community and Student Affairs at Algonquin College's Pembroke campus. This morning's presentation is sponsored by the Local Immigration Partnership of Renfrew and Lanark Counties, a program that is funded by Immigration, Refugees, and Citizenship Canada. Before introducing our guest speaker, I do want to acknowledge that this virtual presentation is being presented on the unceded and unsurrendered territory of the Algonquin people, and we thank them for allowing us to be part of their ancestral lands. We do have an excellent crowd this morning, and as I said, I expect we'll have a few more that will be joining us in a few moments. We had wonderful pre-registration, and really pleased as well that not only do we have people joining us from Lanark and Renfrew, but from across the province and even into the province of Quebec. So we welcome all of you for this important topic, particularly if you are joining us from a rural area. Our guest speaker, Dr. Ryan Gibson, is originally from rural Manitoba. He has a deep intrigue and respect for rural communities, rural people, and the events that shape the futures of these areas. Growing up witnessing the transformations in rural development, agriculture, and their influence on communities instilled a fascination and commitment to rural issues for Ryan. Ryan joined the University of Guelph School of Environmental Design and Rural Development in July of 2016 in the Liberal Professorship in Regional Economic Development position. He holds a Bachelor of Arts honors and a master's degree in rural development from Brandon University, and also a doctoral degree in economic geography from Memorial University in Newfoundland. Ryan is the past president of the Canadian Community Economic Development Network and the Canadian Rural Revitalization Foundation. His topic today, again, is attracting immigrants to rural areas during the COVID-19 pandemic. So I'm just going to hand it over to Ryan now, who also has a colleague who is joining him this morning, who he will introduce as part of his presentation. I do want to invite our guests to use the Q&A tab at the bottom of your screen if you would like to pose any questions during Ryan's presentation. His presentation will be about 30 minutes, and then we will open it up and I'll moderate the questions that come in so that Ryan and Lou can respond to those questions. So we hope you enjoy this morning's presentation. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Ryan Gibson.
Jamie, thanks so much for that introduction, and it's a delight to be here this morning to chat about immigration to rural and small towns, particularly as we are in the midst of this pandemic and are and thinking about kind of what does it look like post-pandemic as on this front. So delighted to see everyone. Welcome to everyone wherever you might be. Hopefully everybody is well as we're moving forward through all of these changes. This morning, I am delighted to be joined by Louis Helps. Lou is a PhD student at the University of Guelph and has been doing a number of really important pieces of research and community development around immigration in rural communities. And so Lou's gonna join me in this presentation that we provide this morning. As Jamie alluded to, we're going to maybe break the presentation over the next 20 to 25 minutes into three main components. One is looking at the state of rural immigration and where we were at just before the pandemic started. The second section will look at what have the impacts and the disruptions been in rural immigration and for newcomers settling in small communities since the pandemic started. And then finally, we'll wrap up our discussion with some commentary around what does all of this mean in terms of welcoming community initiatives and strategies and for newcomers themselves? Now, I'll say right from the get-go, we don't have any silver bullets in terms of how immigration can respond to the current pandemic, but happy to share some insights that we've had from other jurisdictions across the country as we start to move forward. As Jamie also said, we welcome the opportunity for questions and comments and discussions. So please feel free to include those into the chat box at any point in time. One of the other pieces of information that'll be in the chat box is that much of this research emerged from a report that was issued by the Canadian Rural Revitalization Foundation. One of the things that they discovered very early on in the pandemic was that small towns, often not well articulated in their experiences and their challenges in terms of policy and in the media coverage. And so the Canadian Rural Revitalization Foundation set out a year-long endeavor to create what they called rural insights on various different topics on how the pandemic was influencing rural communities. So I'd encourage you to take a look at those at any point in time. So to start with, let's look at the state of immigration to rural and small towns. In Canada, we have this phenomenon that is referred to as MD, where almost 85% of all newcomers into Canada reside as their first point of destination in either Montreal, Toronto, or Vancouver. So most newcomers to Canada end up in one of these three cities. We also know that after those three cities, we have a series of second-tier urban areas where immigrants choose to live, places like Ottawa, Quebec City, Winnipeg, Calgary, Edmonton. And what this has meant is that rural and small towns often have received very low numbers of newcomers. However, this tide is changing over the past 10 to 20 years. And you can see an assortment of news articles that have come recently, really illustrating that rural communities are increasingly looking at being a welcoming community for newcomers and trying to attract and to settle newcomers into those communities. And why they're doing this is a bit diverse. It could be issues around employment opportunities, trying to address labor shortages that exist in our rural and small towns. It could also be around succession planning for businesses that are in our communities. We also know that some small towns have approached immigration as an opportunity to grow populations, either to enhance existing growth or to perhaps change the tide from declining populations that have been witnessed. And we also see many rural communities adopting immigration strategies as an opportunity to increase cultural diversity. If we look at the statistics around what's happened from the most recent census data, we know that there are approximately 146,000 immigrants living in rural Ontario. About 5% of all immigrants reside in rural communities. And between 2011 and 2016, approximately 8,000 new immigrants arrived in rural communities across the province. Most of rural communities' experience with immigration, though, happened before 1980. So we've had some long-standing immigration patterns that have been there that were largely associated with events like the First and Second World War, as well as some other migration patterns. If we look at the immigrants arriving into Ontario, you can see the pattern on this map. This is the census subdivisions on the map that you can see, and the number that's in each census subdivision reflects how many newcomers and new immigrants arrived in the area. So when we look to places like Lanark and Renfrew, we can see approximately 350 arriving in Renfrew and 180 into Lanark County. But you can see the dominance on this map of the purple colored areas around Toronto, Peel, and in Ottawa, where most of the new immigrants into Ontario are arriving. So when we think of rural and small towns in terms of attracting newcomers to our communities, we have some opportunities and some challenges that have been presented before COVID-19. One of the challenges was around distance and density. Often small towns are located a fair number of kilometers from urban areas, which has an influence on access to services in terms of both REIT services, health services, education, as well as settlement services. We also know that rural communities have smaller employment markets and a smaller number of employment opportunities, and historically have had a lower cultural diversity than some of our urban areas. At the same time, we know that rural communities have a much stronger sense of place and sense of attachment that helps newcomers to feel a sense of belonging, a stronger voluntary and charitable section. We have typically more affordable housing in small towns. We have many employment opportunities. And more important is a quality of life that many people are looking for. So this has been the context that led us into the pandemic, but I'll maybe turn it over to Lou to chat about maybe some of the disruptions that have been taking place because of COVID-19.
Thank you, Ryan. I guess we'll just move on to the next slide and I can start talking about the impact of COVID-19 on rural immigration. And some of the things that I'd like to highlight in this presentation are that there are a number of issues that have affected rural newcomers during the pandemic that were already existing before the pandemic, but have very much come to the forefront of our attention as a result of all the pressures and stresses of COVID-19. As with so many issues, you know, we're seeing a lot of new attention being paid to some very important issues. Issues around race, issues around the division, the gender division of labor in our communities that of course already existed before COVID-19, but are much harder to ignore in the current context. So I'm going to be touching on some of these subjects that of course were already around, but are seemingly much more in the news recently. So there are a number of ways in which COVID-19 has hindered rural immigration. Number one, and the most obvious one, being border closures and restricted travel. So in March 2020, the Canadian government closed the Canadian border and travel into Canada to pretty much everyone who is not currently a Canadian citizen or permanent resident, with the exception of some essential workers. And so this has had the impact, of course, of separating families, of separating people from their loved ones and friends and cultural communities in their home countries, making it much more difficult for people to travel back to the country that they came from originally in order to participate in family events or cultural events. And so, of course, that is a big impact. Secondly, it has disrupted many employment opportunities in rural areas. As we've seen, there has been huge unemployment as a result of the pandemic, particularly in the services sector. And this has, of course, affected rural areas just as it has urban areas. And of course, it is important to note that these disruptions don't affect everyone equally. In particular, there is a very big difference, a very big gender gap in the effects of employment disruptions in rural communities. Thirdly, there's been disruptions to immigrant settlement service delivery, as many of these services have had to move online, which is particularly difficult in rural areas given the lack of access to proper broadband, high-speed internet in many places, but also difficulties getting volunteers to perform the services that they regularly would, given safety concerns, the need for social distancing in order to reduce the spread of COVID-19. There's been increased pressure on housing from urban residents relocating. Of course, we've seen a lot of people from urban centers wanting to move out to rural areas because living in a city is not very much fun right now. And the rural areas provide much more opportunity for outdoor activities, for socially distanced gatherings. And so there's been a big increase in the demand for housing in rural areas, which was already scarce to begin with. Immigration processes have been slowed down, and this applies to a broad range of immigration processes, such as economic migration processes, work visas, family reunification, and refugee status applications, of course. As I already touched on, limited broadband connectivity has a major impact on people's ability to connect with services, but also their ability to connect with family members, with cultural communities. And so in rural areas, this is particularly difficult for many newcomers who are looking to stay connected to those communities during the pandemic. Decreased access to health and social services is a particularly grave problem in rural areas, of course, especially in the context of many communities lacking access to high-speed internet or public transit or vehicle access to these services. And finally, interregional and interprovincial travel has been strongly discouraged during the pandemic for obvious reasons. And while this is very important, it does, of course, separate many rural newcomers from cultural communities, religious communities that tend to be more located in urban centers. And that can, of course, be a big stressor, a big cause of mental health problems, a big cause of disconnection within families. And so that is also a big impact. Moving on to the next slide now, we wanted to highlight some of the impacts by immigrant type. And so we have here four broad categories of immigrants to Canada: international students, economic class immigrants, refugees, and temporary migrants. And as you can see by our Venn diagram, there is, of course, overlap between all these groups. There are ways in which they are affected similarly by the pandemic, but they are also each different and have different needs and priorities and obstacles that they face during the pandemic. So in particular, we wanted to highlight the issues affecting two groups that we feel are typically underrepresented in the media and in discussions of rural immigration. Number one being international students. I think that a lot of people assume that there aren't international students in rural areas, or at least that there aren't many of them. But of course, rural communities in Canada are home to many colleges and university campuses. And on these campuses, there are, of course, international students. And they face particular issues and obstacles that their Canadian counterparts on these campuses and other international students that are on urban campuses do not face to the same degree. So one way in which they're affected by COVID-19 has been loss of income. Of course, as I already touched on, unemployment and changes in the labor market have been a particularly notable impact of the pandemic. And so a lot of job opportunities for international students in rural communities have disappeared, particularly in the services sector. Secondly, closure of educational facilities is, of course, a very big impact. A lot of universities and colleges have had to close recreational facilities, athletic facilities, residence facilities, and of course, many classes moving to online distance education rather than in-person classes. And all of this can have an impact on international students' well-being. If residences are closing, then they need to find alternative housing within the community, which of course in rural communities is much more scarce than in urban centers. The lack of ability to use facilities such as gyms or health services on campus can have an impact on international students' health, and the lack of in-person class can have an impact on mental health and well-being as they're not interacting with their peers as much as they normally would. Uncertainty of whether to remain in Canada or return home is something that we have seen a lot with international students. Some, of course, early in the pandemic made the decision to return home, to be with their families, to be in their home countries, and then have later faced the decision of whether or not to return to Canada for a new school year, which can be a challenging issue to decide when a lot of the reason for being here, for being in classes, for being on campus, connecting with peers, is no longer an option. Also, some have likely experienced some difficulties if they wanted to return to Canada, what with requirements to self-isolate, which have become even more stringent and difficult over time. And finally, many international students are not eligible for COVID-19 support programs such as the CERB, which have been provided to Canadian residents. Often these programs have eligibility requirements around residents in Canada, full-time residents in Canada. And so they're not seeing the same level of financial support and services as other Canadians during the pandemic. Moving on to our next slide, the other group that we wanted to highlight is temporary migrant workers. Of course, this group has been much more in the news in the past year, particularly around temporary migrant workers on farms in the agricultural sector, given the high number of cases and unfortunately several deaths in that workforce. But there are several impacts on this group of immigrants that we wanted to highlight that we feel are not being as addressed in the public conversation around these issues. Number one being issues around delayed employment and loss of income. So particularly if we think back to March of 2020 when the borders were closed and a lot of people who were not Canadian residents or citizens were excluded and unable to come into the country. This had an impact on a lot of migrant workers who were initially not made exempt from those regulations and were unable to reach their employers in Canada. So there were delays to their employment. Additionally, as even after they were allowed into the country, international travel has been severely affected by the pandemic. You know, there are not as many flights as there normally are. Flights are more expensive. Upon arrival in Canada, there is an expectation to quarantine for 2 weeks, which are 2 weeks that they cannot work and earn income to send back to their families in their home countries, which is typically their main reason for being here. Secondly, there are known problems with vulnerability to illness and other negative health outcomes amongst temporary migrant workers. Although these workers are given access to Canadian public health care, provincial public health care through the programs that they enter Canada in, they are legally entitled to things like OHIP. Many of them struggle to actually access health services due to language barriers, but also due to fear that they will be repatriated to their home countries and deprived of their income in Canada if they are known to be ill by their employer. And so this has been a problem that we've seen in the past with these temporary migrant workers, and it seems to also be a problem during the pandemic, particularly seeing those large case numbers on farms that employ migrant workers. Next, we have variability in working conditions. So a lot of migrant workers are in positions that we refer to as the 3D jobs, which is dirty, dangerous, and difficult. And so these are the jobs that typically most Canadian citizens and residents don't want to take. They are low paid. Usually they require a lot of physical, intense manual labor. Often they involve use of dangerous equipment or chemicals such as pesticides, and they're not particularly well compensated for the level of difficulty associated with them, to say the least. So during the pandemic, what we've seen is that, especially being more isolated in their workplaces and isolated from the rest of the community in which they live, it opens up further vulnerability to exploitative conditions. And so finally, that brings me to the social isolation of temporary migrant workers, which has always been a very big issue with these programs, particularly in rural areas where there are not usually existing cultural communities for migrant workers to bond with and integrate into, but especially during the pandemic, as migrant workers are often being discouraged from interacting with the rest of the community in which they reside, often being asked to stay solely at the workplace or the residence that they are offered by their employer. And so there are likely to be severe impacts from this on migrant workers' sense of well-being and mental health and their relationship with their communities, their families, and other workers. So what we have learned in the COVID-19 pandemic as it relates to rural immigration, number one is that rural immigration challenges are not the same as urban immigration challenges. There are a number of ways in which rural areas see different challenges and obstacles around immigration and services for immigrants than urban areas, primarily lack of resources, lack of high-speed internet to help people remotely, but also different needs of the immigrant populations as they are separated from cultural communities that exist in urban centers. Secondly, there has been a lot of increased stress and uncertainty for rural immigrants due to COVID-19, uncertainty around immigration processes, uncertainty around when they will be able to see friends, family, cultural communities, religious communities again. And this has had a severe impact on immigrants' mental health and well-being. Thirdly, there's been increases in discrimination and racism towards newcomers. In particular, we can think about the recent very troubling uptick in hate crimes and discrimination against Asian newcomers, in particular in the United States and Canada, with particularly disturbing recent incidences of violence in the United States. But we can't assume that Canada is so different from the United States that we are immune from these issues. Next, we have newcomers facing additional vulnerabilities, which are often unnoticed. So newcomers' needs, particularly in rural communities, tend to be invisible to the rest of the local population, or at least most people in those populations. There is an assumption that there are not many newcomers, or that there are no newcomers in many rural areas, which is of course false. There are fewer than in urban areas, but it is still a significant portion of the population that has real needs that need to be addressed. Additionally, spaces for building welcoming communities have been compromised by social distancing. Of course, it is very necessary that we contain COVID-19 and stop the spread as much as we can by using measures such as social distancing, but this has compromised the ability to integrate newcomers within communities, to provide services to them, to provide cultural integration and events that are so important to them in their first few years in Canada. Broadband connectivity is a very critical issue for rural immigrant settlement and for rural immigrants themselves, in order to connect with services that they need and with their own communities and friends and family. Next, innovative support for rural newcomers is a positive thing that we have seen coming out of this pandemic. A lot of settlement service organizations in particular have really been stepping up to fill this need and to address the needs of newcomers during the pandemic. In particular, we've seen a lot of collaboration between urban and rural settlement services in order to pull resources and cover the needs of that underserviced rural newcomer community. And finally, human and financial capital is nearing exhaustion. Rural settlement services are severely underfunded and undersupported. They largely rely on volunteers, which of course is more challenging during the pandemic, and they need all the support they can get from government at the local, provincial, and federal level. And having said that, I'm going to turn things over to Ryan, and he can finish things up for us by talking about welcoming communities during COVID-19.
Yeah, thanks for that, Lou. And it's useful to hear of all of those challenges and impacts that are taking place within our communities that we need to be mindful of as we move forward. And so maybe the first thing I would say is that, you know, as was illustrated, is COVID has disrupted pretty much everything. All the ways that we did things, how we, the goals we strive for, the priorities, everything has been disrupted. And rural communities and small towns are not immune to any of this, although impacted differently. But I think one of the really exciting messages that I've been hearing throughout all of this over the last 12 months and continuing is that it's not doom and gloom. Rural and small towns have rallied to find those innovative strategies and to depict the way in which they've delivered their programming. And that's really exciting to see innovation, that commitment by multiple stakeholders. So when we look to the COVID-19 landscape and what does this mean for welcoming communities, even while we're still in the pandemic, I think there's an opportunity to rethink around how we've designed welcoming community strategies, as well as how do we implement the activities. As Lou mentioned, the traditional spaces where we might welcome newcomers, whether that is community dinners, whether that is recreation and leisure activities, largely haven't been able to take place because of social distancing requirements, which means we need to start thinking about how can we bridge electronic methods to bridge those traditional venues where we would do welcoming community activities, where we would help to integrate newcomers and to welcome them into our communities in new and different ways. And we've seen some really creative things that have been happening on this front. We also, though, because of the discouragement of interregional travel and interprovincial travel, as we're thinking about attracting newcomers into our communities that maybe are already in Canada or are in their home countries, we need to make sure that the information about our communities is up to date on websites, because they don't have that opportunity to actually maybe physically visit, to see the landscape, to understand the dynamics of the various different organizations and opportunities that exist in those small towns. So we need to make sure that that information is really up to date, so that we're portraying and sharing the right information. The pandemic has also illuminated that we need to continue having multi-stakeholder approaches to addressing welcoming communities and information sharing. The task of attracting and welcoming newcomers is not the sole purview of any level of government, nor of business, nor of the voluntary sector. And so we need to make sure that we've got really robust and dynamic multi-stakeholder approaches, where we've got tables or proverbial tables that we can share information about newcomers. We can think about how to co-design activities, because everyone is needed in these efforts. We've also realized that what's attracting newcomers to rural and small towns largely hasn't changed. It's still focused around job opportunities, around accessible and affordable housing, and around quality of life. And so as we move through the pandemic and into a post-pandemic landscape, the drivers of why newcomers are choosing to settle into rural communities largely isn't changing. And so I think we've got the core foundation to continue that message. One of the really important things, though, that we need to make sure we are mindful of is the tendency to do per capita funding formulas for settlement services for newcomers. We tend to do this on a, as I said, a per capita basis, which in rural communities means there are smaller numbers of newcomers moving in, which often means that there's smaller amounts of funding that are available for those services. During the pandemic, many rural communities have not welcomed as many newcomers as they normally would. And if we were to simply kind of extrapolate the per capita funding formulas, that actually might mean that settlement services actually receive less funding moving forward, because there's been no newcomers over the last year or even 2 years. That being said, the demand for those settlement services has not decreased. And in many instances, settlement services and other community organizations are actually providing more services than they have before. And the delivery of those services is actually more costly due to PPE and maybe sort of new technology to do so. So we need to be mindful of how we actually resource settlement services for newcomers. So perhaps just to end, there are a few things that we might give consideration to around how we move forward. We've got to mitigate the negative impacts of COVID-19 that Lou identified, and there are many more. Those are illustrative of the impacts that are taking place. And it's been really exciting to see how rural communities have stepped up to this challenge. We absolutely need to advocate for rural strategies that are unique from urban strategies. There's many things we can learn from our large cities, but rural communities are fundamentally different, and we need to be mindful of that, which leads us into that third bullet, which is we really need to ensure that we have place-based strategies and approaches for attracting newcomers and welcoming newcomers in the long term. And we've got great evidence of this happening, but we need to make sure that we can continue to do that, whether it's around ensuring financial resources or in terms of human resources, to ensure that we can do the best that we can based on the local priorities and the local assets that we have in our communities. And the last one I'll leave with here is the need for evidence-based decision-making. And this is incredibly challenging for small towns, as often the evidence that's collected is not readily available for communities. We tend to aggregate data at larger scales, and that hides the dynamic of what's happening in small towns. So to ensure that we make the best decisions with our place-based approaches, we need to make sure that we have access to information. Some of that may come from different levels of government, but some of that might actually be housed within our own communities and through our organizations, that we need to be finding ways to share that information. At the end of the day, I also think we have a great opportunity to celebrate a number of the successes and achievements that have been generated over the past number of months from rural and small towns as they've addressed issues of immigration and welcoming communities. And we have a huge opportunity, and this is one example of that, but I think we need a lot more of them, and many of the local immigration partnerships have been at the heart of this, is ensuring that we've got platforms to share our success stories and to share when things maybe didn't go right, so they learn from each other at the end of the day, to really provide a welcoming environment for newcomers that are coming, but also to provide an opportunity to market rural and small communities as a place that is affordable, that has an incredible quality of life, and as a place that people want to be in the long term. So perhaps with that, Jamie, I'll turn it back over to yourself, as there may be some questions, but Lou and I are happy to extrapolate any of the conversation into other areas. There is some information available at that website, but would welcome any feedback, reflections, questions, comments, concerns, and all the rest.
Thank you both, Ryan and Lewis, for your presentation this morning. It's really some good information, including some data, as well as some thoughts and recommendations moving forward around newcomer and immigrant attraction during and in the post-economic recovery from this COVID-19 pandemic. As I mentioned in the chat room to all of our guests who are listening in today, please use the Q&A box to pose any questions that you have. We've also had a few inquiries as to whether or not this presentation, both the slide deck as well as the recording of the presentation, can be shared. The answer is yes, so we will send that out to you. You can also find it on our local immigration partnership for Lanark and Renfrew Facebook page. We will post it there as well and on our website. I will just start with one of the questions that's been posed. Can you talk about backlogs in application processing and any updates, if you know of them, and support to newcomers during pandemic during this waiting period? Newcomers who are fearful for their status because of backlogs and how we as a community can support them.
Yeah, it's a great question, and I'll maybe start, and Lou, you can add some comments as well. I think it's an incredible challenge, and unfortunately, there's no really clear-cut answer to the backlogs. And I think the backlogs also differ based on the type of immigrant and newcomer that are there. So for international students, there may be different realities around that backlog versus migrant workers versus refugees or economic class immigrants. So my understanding is that the backlogs are substantial. They're not getting quickly addressed. They're being addressed in due course, but there is such a significant backlog that it is casting all sorts of uncertainties around this. For international students, I know that there are all sorts of challenges related to both the backlog here in Canada, but also the backlog at Canadian embassies overseas, and many instances, the inability to access those physical offices because of the COVID-19 pandemic health guidelines. Here in Canada, I've been impressed with our members of parliament at federal level who have been advocating and trying to help many individuals who are caught in the backlog and trying to resolve the situation. But in general, I think it's incredibly challenging. The anecdotal experience I have is that one person's experience in the backlog looks very different to another person's experience, even when they're in the same immigration category. And so it creates just a gigantic condition of uncertainty. And I've not really heard of many resources that have been that are out there that are providing relief to immigrants on this question. But I'm not sure, Lou, if you've got other persons on that front.
No, I think that you covered it pretty well, Ryan. I I think that the impact of these backlogs and delays is still largely unknown, but is likely to be quite severe. You know, the impact on newcomers for their mental health and well-being, yeah, as they're waiting to find out more, as they're waiting to see relevant files and cases evaluated, it's hard to imagine. I think for any of us who are Canadian citizens and lifelong residents of Canada, the amount of stress that would create for a person. And so I do think that addressing that backlog should be a priority for the government, and that helping newcomers dealing with that issue should be a priority for settlement service organizations and other groups that are looking to help newcomers through the pandemic.
Well, it's another question to you. Do you have any examples of successful programs and ways that small communities are collaborating?
Yeah, so I think there's lots of experience, there's lots of really innovative collaborations taking place across the country. What's really disappointing is that very few of them actually make the news and the media, because I think it's part of the rural dynamic of just getting things done. So there are a few that I can point to, but I'll turn to Lou, as I'm sure you've got a few others. But we can look to immigration collaborations that have been taking place with some of our the urban settlement services. So we can look to communities that are partnering to deliver and get access for rural immigrants that they couldn't provide in the local service districts through the existing immigrant service providers, whether that's around English language training, whether that's around access to healthcare. And so some of the interesting ones that I've seen is some partnerships with libraries to provide public access to broadband internet for appointments. And in some instances, libraries and other facilities had rooms where people could access the internet, but it wasn't conducive to having a doctor's appointment or a social or mental health appointment. And so there have been really interesting examples of where we've set up small cubicles or offices where newcomers can actually access the internet, but also have privacy to have those appointments that shouldn't be conducted in the general library in the general sense. I think there's also been some really interesting work among refugee settlement organizations in just sharing information and sharing knowledge during the pandemic, because often many of the rural immigrant settlement service organizations don't have a robust human resource team that is employed, and they may have one staff member or two staff members that are dealing with everything that the organization provides. And so by connecting to some of their other colleagues, they've been able to share information and find some efficiencies on that front in terms of that knowledge. And we can put some links in the chat box to some of these organizations that are doing so. But for yourself, Lou, one or two kind of innovative solutions that are happening.
Yeah, I think that you've highlighted a lot of really important examples. One thing that I would like to add is that anyone who's interested in knowing more might want to check out the Canadian Rural Revitalization Foundation piece that I believe was shared in the chat box at the beginning of this webinar, because there are a couple of examples highlighted in that report of these sort of urban settlement services extending their support for rural areas during the pandemic, and how that has had a positive impact. One thing that I think is important to consider in these things is that while I certainly welcome urban settlement service organizations offering support to rural areas and rural newcomers, it is important for local voices and local perspectives to be represented when addressing these issues, because as we covered in this presentation, rural and urban immigration related issues are not necessarily always the same. And so having people with local perspectives from local immigration partnerships or immigrant settlement service organizations can be very useful in informing those conversations around how urban organizations can get involved in supporting rural immigration.
Thank you both for those responses. And Ryan has just posted something in the chat room as well that you might want to look at as a resource out of Manitoba. I have a private question that was sent to me here, and this is really a labor market question where the writer is saying, you know, we are struggling to fill positions within our manufacturing facility. We have tried to attract immigrants and newcomers, but we have not been terribly successful. And how does anything change essentially as a result of this pandemic moving forward to make this even more difficult or easier?
Yeah, it's a great question. So in terms of attracting newcomers into those manufacturing jobs, part of it depends, and something that was probably evident throughout the presentation, but maybe worth saying explicitly, is that every rural community and every employer is quite unique. And so the dynamics that any one organization or business or settlement services encounter need to be taken into consideration with kind of in the region, the community that they reside. So I think the short answer is, I think the challenges that existed in attracting newcomers into those positions will continue throughout COVID-19 and in a post-COVID-19 reality. I think the challenge is going to be further hindered by decreasing housing availability in some of these rural communities. So even if one is able to find newcomers that might be interested in those employment opportunities, if housing is not available or is not affordable in the community, that is going to be a huge challenge. Communities that don't have access to broadband internet connectivity, another huge challenge. So I think the immediate answer is that the challenges are going to continue, unfortunately. There may be opportunities to start, and not maybe, there are opportunities to advocate for potential changes that may be making it a bit easier to attract newcomers, particularly if it's through maybe the temporary foreign worker programs that has a series of hurdles and hoops need to be jumped through to be able to access that program. But I unfortunately, I don't think the pandemic is going to make things easier.
Yeah, one thing that I would just highlight around that issue of the temporary foreign worker program and migrant workers more general is that I think that there are a lot of opportunities for change around that right now, some of which might make it unfortunately more difficult for employers, but others which actually offer an opportunity to increase access to migrant labor for a number of sectors, particularly if the federal government makes changes to these programs which increase migrant workers' mobility between employers once they are in Canada. There are considerations around that, both for migrant workers' rights and their ability to move between employers for their own sake to leave a suboptimal position for a better one, but also benefits potentially for employers as it increases the flexibility of these work arrangements and makes them more able to hire migrant workers for shorter duration positions or for unexpected positions that come up without the need to go through the government for a formal review and labor market impact assessment and all of that, all of those sorts of obstacles. But that remains to be seen. None of those issues have been formally addressed yet. It's just something that that I could see being a potential opportunity for change.
Take a few more questions in the chat box. Michael had written, are you aware of EMC's Global Skills Connection Program, which aids companies to bring in immigrants? And he suggests that he had worked through their program, found it very good, and filled in a lot of gaps. He's also provided the link there if anyone is interested. Any comments on the EMC Global Skills Connection Program?
Yeah, I'm aware of EMC and the work that they do in connecting employers to the ability to help attract newcomers and immigrants, which is fantastic. One of the challenges for many rural employers is, unlike some of our large urban employers, is that often there are not huge resources available, human resources available, to go through the incredibly administrative and bureaucratic process of making applications and getting it all sorted out. Many rural businesses don't have in-house legal teams to review documents or an expertise in this area if it's new to them. And so there are a number of organizations that provide or help with those services. Some of them are organized around a sector. Some of them are very broad. EMC would be one of those organizations that is providing some of those support services to help make the experience a bit more enjoyable and perhaps even a bit more efficient on that front.
Just a final question this is my own question. We heard an Ontario budget yesterday and talking about broadband and an opportunity for everyone to have access to broadband within a few years. How much of an impact, you've highlighted it in your presentation today, will this have on immigrant attraction for newcomers in rural areas?
Did you want to start with Lou?
Sure. So I'm not familiar with all of the details of that news, but just speaking broadly, I do think that broadband access and high-speed internet access are one of the biggest obstacles currently for rural immigrants and for rural settlement service providers. And so any increase to access to high-speed internet in rural areas is, of course, welcome for a number of reasons, connecting people with online services, connecting people with family members, friends, communities, religious services, connecting children with their educators. You know, as we're seeing right now with school closures, these do not affect urban and rural areas equally. And so any kind of increase to broadband access in rural areas can only be positive for rural immigration as far as I see it. I think that the real question is around to what extent does this really change the picture of rural broadband access? Is it going to be increasing access in a lot of the areas where we're seeing newcomers being strongly affected by the pandemic and by disruptions around social distancing and inability to access urban centers? And how many immigrants are going to be left out of these plans to expand broadband access? But I'll turn it over to Ryan if you have any more concrete ideas around that.
Yeah, I would echo what you said, Lou, that I think broadband access has been a policy failure in Canada for rural communities for the past 30 plus years. And anything we can do to address that is absolutely critical in terms of employment, in terms of health and social services, family connections, all of the rest. And so I think the more that we can do towards increasing broadband connectivity, particularly for newcomers, it'll pay dividends beyond what we probably have ever anticipated. And we need to do that sooner than later. It also impacts our ability to promote rural and small towns and rural employers to potential newcomers that want to move into rural places. And so the benefits of investing in broadband, we've been able to demonstrate those for the past number of decades. Unfortunately, it hasn't generated action. One of the potential silver linings of COVID-19 has truly illuminated the fault line that rural and northern and Indigenous communities have with the lack of broadband access. So it may be the silver lining that comes out of the pandemic is that we finally have the stick is poking us in the right direction to make that public investment to eliminate the challenge on that front, because it is central to everything that we're doing these days. This is the new economy. And it's not that new. It's been around for a while.
I think we'll wrap up here and thank Ryan and Lewis from the University of Guelph and the Canadian Rural Revitalization Foundation for a presentation about an important conversation for rural areas around newcomer attraction. So we're very, very pleased that the local immigration partnership of Renfrew and Lanark and Algonquin College's Pembroke campus were able to make this possible. And we hope you've enjoyed this morning's presentation. And again, we will send out to you the recording of the presentation this morning to anyone who registered, and that will also include the slide deck. I think that's okay, right, Ryan?
Absolutely, yeah.
For sure. And I do again commend to your attention, we put it in the chat room before you leave. There is some really strong research papers that have been done through the Canadian Rural Revitalization Foundation, all about rural issues, including this one around newcomer attraction. So if you go to their website, you will be able to find additional information. So thank you again, everyone, for joining us. Have a wonderful day, and we'll talk to you again soon.